Hello world, my name is Ihor, and today I would like to wrap up the 2021 with a studio update, talk a little bit about the future plans, and also make a little announcement at the end of the video. But before we jump into the studio update, I would like to tell a little story. I think it was about a year ago when I was ordering yet another stuff on Thomann. You know, one of these orders that has a lot of different little bits and pieces for your studio, like cables or adapters and whatnot, and stuff like that. And I thought it would be great to have tape. You know, this little white tape that you can mark things with. I thought it would be great to put it on cable and mark it as the one going into the Octatrack, for example, or put it on the patch bay and label every input and output from it and stuff like that. So quite handy thing. I found it real quick on Thomann, added to my order and ordered, and a couple of days I received the package, I open it and I get this. It's a marking tape indeed, but it's freaking huge. And it was way much bigger actually, like that. So lesson learned, read description carefully before you ordering, because it clearly says 50 millimeters wide and I've never noticed that. However, this thing later on became one of the most useful things in my studio because I tape everything with it, like cables to surfaces on or underneath the surfaces, or even gear. For example, the stand that I have for modular and the Octatrack over here is taped to the table. And of course it doesn't leave the marks on the surfaces. And also I like the fact that you can cut it with your fingers easily like that, and it does almost the perfect cut over here. So amazing tape. I would highly recommend it for everyone who has a studio. And of course I have an affiliate link in the description down below. And now let's talk about the studio. So first of all, this is my home. I live here. This is like one of the bedrooms I have in my house. And fortunately, this is not the only bedroom that I have. So I do not sleep in this one. I sleep in another one. So this one is a completely dedicated room for my studio and office. And when I think about the arrangement of this studio, I think about the processes that I have to be able to perform here. So make music, make YouTube videos, also work. I'm a software engineer and I work from home, and I think that's gonna remain the norm, at least in the next year. So I need to be able to work here, entertain myself with computer games, listening to music and watching YouTube videos as well. And also it needs to have storage, especially if we are talking about like Dawless setup or outside of the box setup. You need to have a storage or at least some shelves for it, right? And another quite important thing for me in this studio is to be able to perform all the tasks that I mentioned before as much frictionless as possible. For example, if I'm making a YouTube video and if it takes for me 1 hour to set the stage for it, that's a failure. That's not gonna fly on the long term. You might be able to make one video or a couple of them, but if you're planning to make videos regularly and, you know, make a process for it, that's not gonna fly. I need, at least for me, that's not gonna fly. Indeed, this needs to be frictionless, because sometimes this creative thing comes to you and you have to just start doing it, you know? That's the best part of it. Like if you are able to start making music immediately or like in 1 minute, that's the best thing. And that's the metric for me to achieve as well. I do not measure them in metrics indeed, but you got the idea, I guess. And with this in mind, I'm kind of separated the studio in different areas. So first one is YouTube area, where I film and perform all my videos for YouTube. And this is the desk here. And this is most probably the thing you see quite a lot on my YouTube channel, right? So the next thing is music production table. It's right here with all my gear. I'm gonna cover it a little bit later in this video. Then there is an office desk behind, and there is a lot of storage around me here in this room. Let me start with this YouTube desk and cover real quick how I film. So it's quite straightforward. This is an IKEA desk, I think, that like a kitchen desk or something like that. I have a big light over here with a softbox on it and a grid. I use three camera setups. So one is here, one is on top, which films the gear here. And then I have third camera that films from the left angle over here so that it does not appear here on the camera, but films a different angle just to have it, you know, sort of like entertaining, changing different angles and stuff like that. All the cameras that I use are like Sony A6400 and A6500. Also, I have a mic over here. This is a shotgun mic, V-Mic D3 Pro. And of course, I have some lights around as well, specifically for YouTube. Also, I have an iPad off screen that gives me all the guidance. I have water over here, you know, usual like backstage stuff. So that's pretty much it when it comes to my YouTube desk. Let's switch to the music production desk. And this is my main music production desk. And this is the place where I have most of my gear connected to each other with some purpose. And also this is the place where I spend time making tracks, working on sound exploration, or experimenting with different setups and gear. And before I jump into talking about the gear and the audio and USB and MIDI routing, I would like to talk a little bit about the purpose of this particular place. This place is multifunctional again, so I have to be able to do like Dawless jams on it. I have to be able to do sound design sessions on it and record straight into the Ableton. And also I have to be able to do some kind of experimentation or careless jamming and again being able to record into DAW. And also I need to be able to have a hybrid solution so that I can have some things inside of my DAW, but also playing together with the gear over here. But about this a little bit later when it comes to audio routing, because that's where things get a little bit tricky and interesting. But now let's talk about the gear. So I have several areas here. So the first one and the most important one, the main, I call it main deck. It's this one. The first thing here is analog rhythm. It stands here in the center of the entire setup. And this is the main drum machine or drum synthesizer that I use for creating samples or working on the tracks. So this is the piece of gear where everything starts. This is really powerful, really crazy drum machine, analog drum machine with lots of sonic characteristics and possibilities. I really, really love it. It's quite expensive and quite specific for the use case. I often get asked the question whether like analog rhythm or the Digitact. It's a tricky one because these things are so different. Like they are samplers. Both of them are samplers in a way. So maybe rhythm is a little bit limited if you compare it to the Digitact when it comes to sampling and stuff. However, rhythm, you pay money for analog circuitry inside of rhythm. That's the main difference. This thing is not a sampler, first of all. It's an analog drum synthesizer. So the next thing here is the Octatrack, and this is the centerpiece of this entire Dawless setup. If you look at all the gear that is here, it's in a way connected to the Octatrack. So the Octatrack is a sampler and is a live performance tool, the effects box. There are so many applications to that. And also I'm using it as a MIDI sequencer for rest of the gear if I need MIDI, for example, for Pro 3 or modular. And that's where I come to the modular. This is my 104 HP palette case. And my approach to modular is quite simple. I have like a tiny synthesizer, which I keep changing depending on the situation or depending on the wheel. But there are some certain modules, for example, that almost never leave my case. One of them is Emitter Versio, which is right now, I don't even know what it is right now over here, probably Ruina Versio. So the Versio, I have different videos about it. It's an amazing module and you can change the software in it. I will highly recommend you to get one. This is amazing. I'm planning to get more than just one. Then I have my filter, which is Polaris, my favorite filter for stuff. Also, I have Mimetic and Scales combination over here for CV sequencing and modulation sequencing. This one, Steppy, is always here. This is the step sequencer. Then there is MIDI and some other modules. And last but not least, on the main deck is Zoya. And modular goes straight into the Zoya. So basically, Zoya is a good addition to my modular case when I need anything. So for example, sometimes you need a compressor. So I would have it here on Zoya, or maybe some additional effects or reverb and stuff like that. So this one is like a Swiss Army knife at the end of the chain after modular. And I use it just with modular, not with anything else. So that's pretty much it when it comes to the main deck. And on the left from the main deck, I have a Pro 3, the sequential, amazing analog and digital synth. I really, really like how it sounds. I have a funny story about it though. I ordered it, I think about a year ago or something, and here from like a local shop in the Netherlands, and they sent me a box with a new brand new synthesizer. I played with it for a week. I was quite excited about it. And then I put my headphones out and I played without headphones. And I've heard some metallic sound coming from the inside of it. So there was some kind of disattachment or something. I have no idea what it was. And I reached out to the shop and asked them to send me another one, because this one seems to be broken. You know, I don't need some metallic sounds coming from inside of the synthesizer because it's weird. And I wanted to replace this one, you know, with a new one. So what the shop did, they sent me a new one. I received it. But they didn't care about the old one, which was quite weird. And we are talking about 1500 euros synthesizer. So I had to spend my energy and some time, I think it took me a month or even more, to figure out how can I return it back to them. That's ridiculous, isn't it? Anyways, Pro 3 is amazing synthesizer. I really love it. It sounds really good. The bass line, I just love how the bass sounds straight out of the box. You put the square wave, a little bit of filter, envelope a little bit, done. Job is done. Like, no sound design session for a long time. Just take this one and it sounds amazing. And then you can go deep, deep, deep and deeper. And right in front of the Pro 3, there is an empty place. And here I have my cables. And this place is sort of like an experiment place. For example, if I need to put some other synthesizer that is not here, for example, I have a Minilog XD. So if I would like to do something on the Minilog, it would come here. I will be able to easily connect it to everything else and then do some sound design or whatever I wanted to do, and then disconnect and put it out and have this place to, you know, to kind of interchangeable situation. And now we come to the right part of the main deck. And here I have the Digitact over here. And without any overstatement, this is the best drum machine I've ever owned. I think I spent the most time with this particular machine than with any other machine I have here. I use it quite a lot on my YouTube desk. This is the best little sampler that I have, and I cannot be happier than I am with it right now. And if you don't have one, you should get one. You will never regret getting one. And there is an affiliate link in the description down below, of course. And next to the Digitact, I have Analog Hit. This is the analog distortion from Elektron. It has 8 different circuits. The most one that I use is the saturation circuit, and I would have it on the master. So for example, the beats from scratch, when I do the final take, I will always run it through the saturation circuit in the post, like the master, and then through Ozone 9 to have mastering. So quite useful thing here. And then I have Push, of course, and Push is great. It's the best thing you can have with Ableton. I don't know if you even need Ableton without the Push, actually. So, and I have it here to serve all kinds of different purposes. One of my favorites, though, is that you can, on Push, you can select the fixed length of the recording, for example, 2 bars or 4 bars, and then record quantized loop of your modular or drums or something like that. I can jam on the Push itself as sort of like a Dawless way, and many, many more. Basically, it gives me all the controls I need over Ableton on this desk without me staring at the screen over there if I jam in a hybrid solution or if I record into Ableton. So Push is great. And right here I have my Mackie. It's a little analog mixer, and that's where I think it makes sense to talk about the audio routing, because that's where things become a little bit interesting. So, and I'm gonna start with the rhythm. So rhythm, outputs from the rhythm, they go into the octatrack inputs A and B always. So on the inputs A and B, I have my drums, I have only analog rhythm. But then when it comes to inputs C and D on the octatrack, I have master output from the Mackie, this mixer over here, connected into the inputs C and D of the octatrack. And then the rest of the gear that I have here, right now it's a Pro 3 modular and Digitact, they are connected into the Mackie. In that way, I can mix these synthesizers on this little mixer and route them into the octatrack for sampling or for playing live or for whatever reason I need. And another use case for Mackie over here is that the alternative output from the Mackie is connected straight into the interface right underneath the desk. I'm gonna come to it a little later, but now this. So basically that allows me to route different synthesizers either to the Octatrack or to the interface, straight into the interface. And this is where the tricky audio routing comes into place. For example, if I mute the modular on the Mackie, it's gonna automatically send it into the alternative output and it's gonna go into the interface. And then I have the master output from the Octatrack going into interface as well. So basically two stereo outputs from the entire desk, the Octatrack and the Mackie that can go into the interface. And if I need to do a Dawless jam, then everything goes into the Octatrack and I jam and I do all of this. But the moment I need to work on some sound design or just do some sort of like careless jam on modular, I would just route it straight into the interface over Mackie, bypassing the Octatrack and everything else. Hope that makes sense. And that's where I think this particular setup is quite unique for me and it works really good. And another thing when it comes to audio routing is the analog heat. I have it patched into the patch bay, so both inputs and outputs. And by default, the Octatrack goes through it, but I can use the patch bay to repatch it because sometimes I need analog heat to be part of the chain after the modular, for example. I need to use the mid drive for my modular. That can be easily done on the patch bay, actually. Now, when it comes to MIDI, this is my main clock if I'm using the Dawless setup, and Ableton is my main clock if I'm using the hybrid setup. So basically, MIDI-wise, I have 5-pin MIDI coming from the rhythm into the Octatrack, and then the output from the Octatrack goes into the MIDI, you know, this little MIDI solutions box, which has one MIDI input and then four MIDI through outputs. And then I can connect every single synthesizer to it and use different MIDI tracks on the Octatrack to sequence them. And that's also where I can easily connect the external, like any gear which is not here on this experimental place. I can put my MIDI log, quickly connect MIDI cable and then audio cable into Mackie. And yeah, pretty much done. It's all working and I can sequence it from the Octatrack. And right now from this MIDI box, of course, Pro 3 is connected. The modular is connected, and usually if I need a Zoya to be in clock, I would connect this thing into Zoya. And then MIDI through track goes into the Digitact, and from the Digitact into the analog heat. Right now cable is missing, but I usually have it. I don't know why, because I never use the LFO on the analog heat. Maybe I should, but yeah, it works like that for me as well. So I think that's pretty much it when it comes to MIDI. And now USB-wise, I have all Elektron gear, but Octatrack connected to this little over hub, which is like the USB hub from Elektron, and connected into the computer so that I can use the VST plugins. For example, to use the analog heat, I usually use the VST plugin over USB. It works just flawlessly. And only rhythm synced to Ableton, because the rest is connected to rhythm MIDI. It introduces a little latency here and there, but it's totally fine for my creations. I'm not talking about like 50 or 30 milliseconds latency, I rather like 2 or 5 milliseconds and stuff like that. Basically in Ableton, I have only rhythm enabled in MIDI, and also I calibrated the latency of the rhythm and Ableton. And whenever I start the sequence in Ableton, it's gonna automatically start sequencer in the rhythm and hence the whole thing over the 5-pin MIDI. And of course the push is connected to the USB as well. And right here underneath the desk I have my little rack, or I call it main dock station, where I have audio interface, my patch bay, power cables, everything is connected to that. I have my Mac dock station there, and everything is basically somehow connected to this main dock. And this main dock was a happy accident as well, because I went to this like secondhand shop here in the Netherlands. It's called Kringloopwinkel, with a lot of cheap furniture and stuff. And I found this, you know, like the coffee table sort of thing. It was big, heavy, made of wood, I bought it like long time ago and I was using it as a stand for this tree, I think. But later on, I figured out that I can mount the rack units into it because it has exact width of the rack, which was amazing. I was like, seriously, I could do that. And yeah, this became my DIY rack kind of dock station that I have in my studio. And there is a Focusrite Scarlett audio interface that I use. There is a cheap patch bay and also a few power sockets in it. Yeah, I think that's pretty much it when it comes to this music production desk. Let's switch and talk a little bit about the office desk. And this is my office desk, and that's the place where I do my work as an engineer, where I work on my music in Ableton, where I work on my videos in DaVinci Resolve, where I play games on my PC and I listen to music. So this is like a normal office desk. Also, I like my working space to be sort of clean and tidy. That helps me to maintain the deep focus when I work on the tasks. So that's why there is not that many things on this desk. I do have my Mac over there. This is a 16th inch Intel Mac. My headphones, the Beyerdynamic DT770, and studio monitors, of course. These are Adam Audio T7V. Great monitors, not too expensive. And I do use the SonarWorks Sound ID to calibrate them, but that's mostly because of the room, and room by any means is not treated acoustically. I just put this. These are actually the black ones that you see around my studio. These are the moving blankets from Amazon. And I put them as sort of like curtains so that they cover the flat walls. And I don't have that much high-end reverb coming from them. That's the only acoustic treatment I have in this room. And one quite important thing to have on your desk is a bottle of water and the glass. I used to have them somehow, you know, not on the desk, but rather somewhere else. But then I forget to drink and I forget to hydrate, and hydration is quite important. So use this trick to stay healthy and hydrated. And right here behind me, I have shelves where I store some things, for example, modules or cables and different stuff that I need immediately in the studio. And also behind these the curtains, I have some extra storage for all kinds of different things, because this room is underneath the roof, as you can see the windows here. And there is a storage going like that so that I can store like boxes from modules and synthesizers and stuff like that. That's it for the office desk and storage. Let's jump back to the YouTube desk. I think that's pretty much it when it comes to the studio arrangement. I hope I was able to explain it properly and you got the ideas behind it. And I really hope that you got some inspiration as well. Let me know if you have any questions. Feel free to ask them in the comment section down below. I will try to answer as much as possible. I usually try to answer most of the comments. And when it comes to plans for 2022, of course, I'm going to continue working on this YouTube channel. So stay tuned. More videos to come. I have a big list of ideas, and also you share ideas with me, and it's always appreciated. I really, really, really grateful for that. Another thing, I would like to release my music finally. I've never done that before, but yeah, I mean, imposter syndrome kicks in hard right now. But anyways, and also I have some ideas for streaming the live shows or even doing live shows in the real life when pandemic is gone. And last but not least, and this one is quite important for me, today I launched my Patreon. So if you would like to support me even more, you can become one. You don't have to, but I would really, really appreciate that. So there is a link in the description down below. Check those tiers and figure out. You probably know the drill, how Patreon works and all that, right? I think that's pretty much it for today's video, and I hope you enjoyed watching it, and I hope you've learned something new that you can apply to your own music production workflow. I wish you the best in 2022, and I appreciate all of you, and until the next time, have fun.